Good morning everyone. Today we are going to talk about lymphatic system part 1. Lymphatic system or lymphoid system is an organ system in vertebrates which is a part of circulatory system and the immune system. Now it is made up of large network of lymphatic vessels as you see in this picture. So it is made up of network of lymphatic vessels and the lymphoid organs and the lymph tissues. Okay, the vessels carry a clear fluid called lymph. Let us start with the introduction. The world is not always kind to the human body, right? Accidental collisions and interactions with the objects in our environment produces bumps, cuts and burns. Now the effect of an injury may be compounded by assorted viruses, bacteria and other microorganisms that thrive in our environment. Some of these microorganisms normally live on the surface of and inside our bodies, but all have the potential to cause us a great harm. Right, so these viruses, bacteria and other microorganisms, they cause potential threat to our body. In this ongoing struggle, the lymphoid system plays the primary role. So you have to know the purpose of discussing or studying about the lymphoid system, because it plays an important role in the defensive mechanism. Okay, whenever we get infected with the virus, the bacteria or any other microorganism, so then this lymphoid system plays an important role to fight the infection. The lymphatic system is essentially a drainage system which is accessory to the venous system, that you have to remember. These are the lymphatic vessels or the lymphatic capillaries, and these are the venules. So the lymphatic system is a drainage system which is accessory to the venous system. Most of the tissue fluid formed at the arterial end of the capillaries is absorbed back into the blood by the venous ends of the capillaries. So most of the tissue fluid which is formed at the arterial end of the capillaries, as you can see in this picture, it is absorbed back into the blood by venous end of the capillaries. So these are the venous end of the capillaries. So the remaining tissue fluid, it is absorbed by the lymph capillaries. So these green color one are the lymph capillaries, which begins blindly in the tissue spaces, in the interstitial space, and is sent back to the blood. So that remaining tissue fluid, it is taken up by these lymph capillaries and it is sent back into the blood. Now this lymphoid system, or the lymphatic system, has several components. So what are these several components? Lymph, number one, this is very, very important. Lymph is a fluid connective tissue transported and monitored by this system. So what does the lymphatic system do? It transports lymph. The vessels that carry lymph are known as lymphatic vessels. This is important. And the cells suspended within the liquid are known as lymphocytes. So what does this lymph contain? It contains cells which are known as lymphocytes, which are specialized lymphoid tissues and lymphoid organs, adjust the composition of lymph and produce lymphocytes of various kinds. Now the lymphatic vessels, they originate in the peripheral tissues and deliver lymph to the venous system. We have seen in the previous diagram. Lymph consists of interstitial fluid, which means the tissue fluid which resembles blood plasma. but with a lower concentration of proteins. Then it also contains lymphocytes, the cells which are responsible for the immune response, and macrophages of various types. So this is the composition of lymph. Now lymphatic vessels often begin with or pass through lymphoid tissues and the lymphoid organs, structures that contain a large number of lymphocytes, macrophages, and lymphoid stem cells. Let us discuss about functions of the lymphatic system. It drains excess tissue fluid to the venous system, that is tissue fluid which could not be drained by the venous system. It absorbs fat from the intestine and transports it to the blood. And it helps to provide immunological defense against the diseases or the disease causing agents. So these functions we are going to discuss in detail. So it drains excess tissue fluid to the venous system, that is tissue fluid which could not be drained by venous system. Absorbs fat from the intestine, and from there it transports the fat into the blood. And it helps to provide immunological defense against the disease causing agents. Now let us discuss about in detail about these functions of the lymphatic system. Now, to produce, maintain and distribute lymphocytes, the primary function of the lymphatic system. Produce, maintain and distribute the lymphocytes. Lymphocytes are essential to the normal defensive mechanisms, right? This everyone knows. Lymphocytes, one of the type of the WBCs, they are essential to the normal defensive mechanisms of the body. They are produced and stored within the lymphoid organs. We will discuss what are these lymphoid organs, okay? Like we have spleen, thymus, bone marrow. So these lymphocytes are produced and stored within the lymphoid organs such as spleen, thymus, bone marrow. We will discuss in detail about these lymphoid organs. Now lymphoid tissues and organs are classified as either primary or secondary. So lymphoid organs can be classified into primary or the secondary. Okay. Now primary or the central lymphoid structures are responsible for the development and maturation of the lymphocytes, the primary lymphoid organs. Okay, they are responsible for development and maturation of the lymphocytes. They contain stem cells that divide to produce daughter cells that differentiates into B lymphocytes, T lymphocytes or natural killer cells, NK cells. Okay, this you remember. So what you have to remember in this slide, that we have lymphoid organs such as spleen, thymus, bone marrow, right? They have been classified into primary and secondary. So primary, they are responsible for the development and maturation of the lymphocytes, right? So these lymphocytes, they differentiate into B lymphocytes, T lymphocytes or natural killer cells. The bone marrow and thymus of the adult. Bone marrow, you know, it is present inside the bone, okay? The thymus is a lymphoid organ present in the neck region of the adult, are primary lymphoid structures. However, most immune responses begin in secondary or peripheral lymphoid structures, where activated lymphocytes divide to produce additional lymphocytes of the same type. So most immune responses begin in secondary lymphoid structures. Immune responses, they begin in the secondary lymphoid organs, whereas the development and maturation takes place in the primary lymphoid organs. For example, the division of the activated B cells can produce additional B cells needed to fight off an infection. Secondary lymphoid structures are located at the front lines where invading bacteria are first encountered, examples including lymph nodes and tonsils. So This example you have to remember. The division of activated B cells can produce additional B cells which are needed to fight off an infection. Now the secondary lymphoid structures are located at the front lines, so where invading bacteria are first encountered. Examples for the secondary lymphoid organs is lymph nodes and tonsil. So let us continue with the functions. Lymphatic system maintains normal blood volume and eliminate local variations in the chemical composition of interstitial fluid, nothing but the tissue fluid. So what is the blood volume? So it is 5 to 6 liters. Okay, the blood pressure at the proximal end of a systemic capillary is approximately 35 millimeters of mercury. The pressure at the capillary, 35 millimeters of mercury. Now this pressure tends to force water and solutes out of the plasma into the interstitial fluid, into the tissue fluid. So that means water and solutes, they come into the tissue fluid. So there is a small net movement of fluid from the plasma into the interstitial fluid along every systemic capillary. So the total volume is substantial, approximately we say 3.6 liters to 72% of the total blood volume enters the interstitial fluid each day. So under normal circumstances, this movement goes unnoticed because each day vessel of the lymphoid system return an equal volume of interstitial fluid to the bloodstream. So consequently, there is a continual movement of the fluid from the bloodstream into the tissues and then back into the bloodstream through the lymphatic vessel. So you see, continuous movement of fluid from the bloodstream into the tissue, right? From the bloodstream into the tissue spaces, then from the lymphatic capillaries again into the bloodstream through the lymphatic vessels. So this circulation of the fluid helps to eliminate regional differences in the composition of interstitial fluid, because so much of fluid moves throughout the lymphatic system each day, a break in major lymphatic vessel can cause rapid and potential fatal decline in blood volume. So that you have to remember, only little amount of fluid which is collected in the tissue fluid, it is taken up by the lymphatic capillaries and drains the fluid into the venous system or into the circulation, you can say. This lymphatic system also provides an alternative route for the transport of hormones, nutrients and waste products. For example, certain lipids absorbed by the digestive tract are carried to the bloodstream by lymphatic vessels rather than by absorption across the capillary walls. So these are the functions of the lymphatic system. Now, what are the components of the lymphatic system? The lymphatic system consists of lymph capillaries, lymph vessels, lymphoid organs, lymph node, which are lymph nodes, spleen and thymus. These are the lymphoid organs, and epithelial lymphoid system and bone marrow. So this you have to remember, it comes as a very short notes in the exam, the components of the lymphatic system. Okay, lymph capillaries, blood vessels, lymphoid organs, which are lymph nodes, spleen and thymus, epithelial lymphoid system and bone marrow. Now let us discuss about lymph capillaries. So lymph capillaries, they are present in the interstitial space, that you remember. Lymph capillaries are microscopic blind-ended lymph vessels which begin in the interstitial space, or you can say intercellular spaces. So these lymph capillaries, they begin in the intercellular spaces. They form vast network in the intercellular space of most of the tissues of the body. So in this figure we can make out. See, the walls of the lymph capillaries, like those of the blood capillaries, are made up of single layer of endothelial cells. So these lymph capillaries, they are made up of a single layer of endothelial cells, and also the blood capillaries, they are made up of single layer of endothelial cells. But These lymph capillaries are more permeable to tissue fluid containing large molecules such as protein, particulate matter and colloid material. So you have to note down these points. Lymph capillaries are most numerous in skin and glands and also in serous membranes. Lymph capillaries within the villi of small intestine are called lacteals. So the lymph capillaries which are found at the small intestine, they are known as lacteals. So they absorb fat and transport it to the blood. So this is about the lymph capillaries. The site where lymph capillaries are absent: epidermis, which is a layer of skin, hair, nails, cornea, the articular cartilage, brain and spinal cord, bone marrow and splenic bulb. So these are the sites where you don't find lymph capillaries. Now let us discuss about lymphatic vessels. So we have discussed in the previous slide about the lymphatic capillaries. Now we shall discuss about lymphatic vessels. Now the lymph capillaries unite to form lymphatic vessels. So let's say these are the lymph capillaries 1, 2, 3 and 4. So these lymph capillaries, they unite and they form lymph vessel. So this is lymph vessel. So they are thin walled vessels, 0.5 to 1.0 millimeters in diameter and have beaded appearance. You can see the lymphatic vessels, they are beaded in appearance due to the presence of numerous valves within their lumen. So you can see here one valve and this is one valve. So the presence of numerous valves makes the lymphatic vessel in beaded appearance, okay, due to the presence of numerous valves within their lumen. Now the flow of lymph in the lymphatic vessel is unidirectional. So you can see the flow of lymph, direction of lymph flow, it is unidirectional towards the large veins at the root of the neck due to the presence of these valves. So why there is unidirectional flow of lymph? Because of the presence of these valves. So the lymphatic vessels pass through series of lymph nodes before the lymph is drained into the venous system. So in lymph node, we will discuss in detail about the lymph node, okay? The lymph nodes filter the lymph to make it free from pathogens and harmful agents. The lymph nodes, what they do? They filter the lymph to make it free from pathogens and harmful agents. In fact, once the vessels are formed, they converge on a lymph node. The lymph passes through this lymph node and leaves it through another lymph vessel, which enters the another lymph node. So the lymph leaves this node through yet another vessel. So this process is repeated. The smaller lymph vessels merge to form progressively larger lymph vessels called lymph ducts, which empty into the subclavian veins. So we'll talk about these large lymphatic ducts, okay? So eventually these lymphatic ducts, they empty lymph into the subclavian veins. Now coming to the principal lymph ducts, okay? There are two types of principal lymph ducts. Number one is thoracic duct, the second is right lymphatic duct. Now what is this thoracic duct? It is the largest lymphatic duct in the body. Remember this thing. Thoracic duct is the largest lymphatic duct in the body. It is about 45 centimeters long. This begins as a large sac, as you can see here. Large sac-like dilated lymph channel called cisterna chyli. So this is cisterna chyli. In front of the bodies of L1 and L2 vertebra and ends in the angle between the left internal jugular vein and the left subclavian vein. So here it ends. This is the termination of the thoracic duct. Okay. Between the left internal jugular vein and left subclavian vein. So it drains lymph from whole body except right upper quadrant. So the thoracic duct, it drains lymph from the whole body except the right upper quadrant, from which the lymph is drained by right lymphatic duct. So this portion of the lymph, it is drained by right lymphatic duct. So So the thoracic duct drains the lymph from lower extremities, abdomen, left thoracic region, and left upper limb, and left side of the head and neck. So this you have to remember about the thoracic duct. Now let us discuss about right lymphatic duct. So all of you see, this is the right lymphatic duct. Okay. So right lymphatic duct is a dilated lymph vessel about 1 cm long. It lies in the root of the neck. So you can make out here. It lies in the root of the neck. It is 1 cm long on the right side, and it is formed by the union of 3 vessels. So this right lymphatic duct, it is formed by union of 3 vessels. One is right jugular trunk, then right subclavian trunk, and right brachiocephalic trunk. So right jugular trunk, right subclavian trunk, and right brachiocephalic trunk. Right bronchomediastinal trunk. So right bronchomediastinal trunk, they unite and they form the so-called right lymphatic duct. It ends by opening in the angle between the right brachiocephalic vein and the right subclavius vein. The right lymphatic duct drains the lymph from right upper limb, right thoracic region, and right side of the head and neck. So this you have to remember. In case of the right lymphatic duct, it drains the right upper limb, right thoracic region, and right side of the head and neck. Now, what are the superficial and deep lymph vessels? According to the location, the lymph vessels are divided into 2 types. One is superficial lymph vessel, the other is deep lymph vessels. So superficial, which are found in the superficial fascia deep to the skin. So underneath the skin you find these superficial lymph vessels. They join the deep lymph vessels. Now deep lymph vessels, which are found deep to the deep fascia and accompany the blood vessels. So this you have to remember. So the lymph vessels have been classified into superficial and deep. Now coming to the clinical correlation. What is this lymph edema? About 30 liters of fluid passes from the arterial end of the capillaries into the intercellular spaces every day. Out of this, about 27 liters of fluid consisting of micromolecules are absorbed back by the venous end of the capillaries. So 27 liters of fluid consisting of micromolecules are absorbed back by the venous end of the capillaries. The remaining 3 liters of fluid consisting of macromolecules, protein, fat, droplets, and particulate matter such as bacteria, they are absorbed by the lymph capillaries, which we have seen in the beginning of this class. For this reason, lymphatic system is regarded as a drainage system of the coarse type, and venous system is a drainage system of the fine type. Because so this lymphatic system is draining macromolecules like protein, fat, droplets, and also particulate matter such as bacteria. So that's why the lymphatic system is regarded as drainage system of coarse type and venous system as drainage system of fine type. If extra 3 liters of fluid is not drained by lymphatic system, the accumulation of fluid in the tissue will cause edema. As you can see in these pictures, you see the edema, which is known as the lymph edema, the swelling of the lower limbs and also the upper limbs. Okay, we'll discuss in detail about these conditions. Okay. Now, lymphangitis. Sometimes the lymph vessels become inflamed, leading to lymphangitis. Itis means inflammation of the lymph vessels. This often results in visible red streaks in the skin, extending from the site of infection to the group of lymph nodes where the lymph vessels drain. You can see here. So this is actually the inflammation of the lymphatic vessels. Okay. Example, in infection of red streaks on hand may be seen spreading from the hand to the axilla. Okay. Then we have a condition which is known as elephantiasis. If lymph vessels draining the lower limb are blocked by long slender worms of filaria, the accumulation of fluid in the interstitial spaces and lymph vessels may cause permanent swelling an enlargement of the lower limb resembling an elephant's leg, producing a clinical condition known as elephantiasis. Okay, so these are the clinical correlations related in general to the lymphatic system. Let us discuss about lymphoid organs. Lymphoid organs are made up of lymphatic tissue. The lymphatic tissue is specialized connective tissue, and it consists of lymphatic tissue, a framework of reticular fibers and reticular cells. Lymphocytes mainly and related plasma cells, macrophages. Lymphoid organs are classified into two types. This we have discussed in the previous slides also, but let us have a revision about the lymphoid organs. The primary lymphoid organs, which are involved in the production of lymphocytes, they are bone marrow and thymus. These two are the important lymphoid organs. They are primary lymphoid organs, bone marrow and thymus. They are responsible for production of lymphocytes. Then secondary lymphoid organs, they are involved in activation of lymphocytes and initiation of immune responses. Example, lymph nodes and spleen. Dear students, let us discuss about lymph nodes. Lymph nodes are small oval lymphoid organs ranging in diameter from 1 to 25 millimeters up to around 1 inch. So you can make out here the lymph nodes 1, 2 and 3 and 4. In between you have the lymphatic vessels. A dense fibrous connective tissue capsule covers each lymph node. So all of you see this diagram. So this is dense capsule, connective tissue capsule covering the lymph node. So this is the capsule. Fibrous extensions from the capsule extend part way into the interior of the node. These fibrous extensions are known as trabeculae. So we can see here this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, these are trabeculae extending from the capsule into the substance of the lymph node. So these fibrous extensions are known as trabeculae. Blood vessels and nerves attached to the lymph node at the indentation are hilum. So where is the hilum? So this part is known as the hilum. So where you have blood vessels and nerves are attached at the indentations are the hilum of the lymph node. Each lymph node has two sets of lymphatic vessels. Now this is one lymph node, it has two sets of lymphatic vessels, afferent lymphatic vessels and efferent. So let me show you, these are the afferent lymphatic vessels, right? So this is afferent lymphatic vessels and this is efferent lymphatic vessel. The afferent lymphatic vessel, which brings lymph to the node from peripheral tissues, penetrate the capsule on the opposite side of the hilum. So these afferent lymphatic vessels, what they do? They bring lymph to the lymph node from the peripheral tissues and they penetrate the capsule opposite the hilum. So these are afferent lymphatics. Then lymph flows slowly through the lymph node within a network of sinuses. So lymph flows through the network of sinuses, which are open passages within the incomplete walls. So the sinuses are the open passages with incomplete walls. Upon arriving at the node, the lymph first enters the subcapsular space. So beneath the capsule, there is a space which is known as the subcapsular space. So upon entering the node, the lymph enters the subcapsular space, which contains meshwork of branching reticular fibers and interconnected macrophages and dendritic cells. So you see all macrophages and dendritic cells in the subcapsular space. The dendritic cells connect antigens from the lymph and present them in their cell membranes. T cells encountering these bound antigens become activated, thus initiating an immune response. After passing through the subcapsular space, the lymph flows through the outer cortex of the node. So this is the outer cortex of the lymph node. This is the outer cortex. This is subcapsular space. So after passing through the subcapsular space, the lymph enters the outer cortex of the lymph node. The outer cortex contains aggregated B cells. So in the outer cortex you have, outer cortex contains aggregated B cells, B lymphocytes, with germinal centers similar to those of lymphoid nodules. So these are germinal centers. So pale staining area is known as the germinal center. Okay, so this is to be seen in the cortex of the lymph node. Let us continue with the lymph nodes. Lymph flow continues through the lymph sinuses. So lymph flows through the lymph sinuses deep to the cortex. Now this is the cortex, so it flows deep to the cortex, and it is known as the paracortical area on either side of the cortex. Here circulating lymphocytes leave the bloodstream and enter the lymph node by crossing the walls of the blood vessels within the deep cortex. The deep cortical area is dominated by T lymphocytes. After flowing through the sinuses of the deep cortex, lymph continues into the core. So lymph enters the core, which is known as the medulla of the lymph node. So this is the outer cortex and inner medulla. Now this medulla contains B cells, macrophages and plasmocytes organized into elongate masses known as medullary cords. So you see medullary cords in the medulla of the lymph node. So lymph enters the efferent lymphatics. So this is the efferent lymphatic. So lymph enters the efferent lymphatic at the hilum after passing through network of sinuses in the medulla. Lymph nodes function like a kitchen water filter. They filter and purify the lymph before it reaches the venous system. As lymph flows through the lymph node, at least 99% of antigens present in the arriving lymph are removed. Fixed macrophages in the walls of the lymphatic sinuses engulf debris or pathogens in the lymph as it flows past. Antigens removed in this way are then processed by the macrophages and presented to nearby T cells. Other antigens stick to the surfaces of the dendritic cells where they can stimulate the T cell activity. So dear students, so far we have discussed about the lymph node and its anatomy. So we discussed the flow of lymph through the lymph node and how the lymph enters the efferent lymphatic vessel via the afferent lymphatics. So now let us discuss about the clinical anatomy, lymphadenopathy and metastatic cancer. A minor injury normally produces slight enlargement of the nodes along the lymphatics draining the region. So the enlargement usually results from an increase in the number of lymphocytes and phagocytes in the node. So whenever you see enlargement of the lymph node, you see increase in the number of lymphocytes and phagocytes in the node in response to a minor or localized infection. Chronic or excessive enlargement of lymph nodes constitutes lymphadenopathy. Lymphadenopathy. This condition may occur in response to the scarring of damaged lymphatic ducts, bacterial, viral or parasitic infections or cancer. So these infections only result in lymphadenopathy. Lymphatics are found in most regions of the body and lymph capillaries offer little resistance to the passage of cancer cells. As a result, metastatic cancer cells often spread along the lymphatics. So example, we can say the breast cancer. So if one breast is infected with cancer, so it may spread to the other mammary gland as well. So under these circumstances, the lymph nodes serve as a way station for migrating cancer cells. Thus, An analysis of the lymph nodes can provide information on the spread of cancer cells, and such information has a direct influence on the selection of appropriate therapies. One example is such classification is the best cancer or lymphomas by degree of lymph node involvement. So this is the clinical anatomy related to the lymph node. So dear students, you must remember that about the other lymphoid organs we will discuss in the lymphatic system part 2. So next slide. So in this slide we can make out the swollen lymph nodes, the excess lymph fluid inside the lymph node, and here in this picture we can make out lobular carcinoma in situ, the breast cancer. Okay, so this explains about the lymphadenopathy and the metastatic carcinoma of the breast. So thank you dear students, and in the lymphatic system part 2 we will be discussing about the other lymphoid organs and clinical anatomy related to those lymphoid organs. Okay, go through each and every slide. If you do not understand, kindly text me. I'll clarify your doubts. Thank you very much.